morning. Welcome. We invite you to stand with us. Welcome to Calvary Chapel Summerville. We welcome you if you're watching online. Come all you weary, come all you thirsty, come to the well that never runs dry. Drink of the water, come and thirst no more. Come all you sinners, come find his mercy, come to the table, he will satisfy. Taste of his goodness, find what you're looking for.
God so loved the world.
For God so loved the world that he gave us his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever. Foot of the cross, Jesus is waiting there, open arms. For God so loved the world that he gave us his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever. Now it is well, I'm walking in freedom. For God so loved the world. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him. His love. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, for the wonders of His love, His amazing love. For God so loved the world that He gave us His one and only Son to save us. For God so loved the world that he gave us his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever. The power of hell forever defeated. Now we for God so loved, God so loved the world. Bring all your failures, bring your addictions, come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting, God so loved the world.
We need no other hiding place. I hope it's safe within your name. This we know, this we know. You promise never to forsake. What you begin, you will sustain. This we know, this we know.
I will call upon the Lord, for He alone is strong enough to save. Rise, the shackles are no more, for Jesus Christ has broken every
the heavens and the earth. Announce the fullness of your word. This we know, this we know. And every enemy will flee as we declare your victory.
Lord God, we give you a hand clap of praise. God, you are worthy of all of our praise this morning. We thank you, God. We call upon you this morning, Lord. Father, just humbly, God, seeking a touch from you this morning, God. Thanking you, Lord, for your presence. We thank you that you are an ever-present help in time of need. We thank you, Father, for grace that abounds towards your children. Lord, we thank you, God, that we can gather in this sanctuary, your house, Lord God, to worship you in spirit and in truth. Father, we pray, Lord, against all distractions. We thank you that you are able to break every stronghold as we call upon you, Lord God. We pray, Lord God, search our hearts this morning. And if there be any way in us, God, that is not pleasing to you, God, we desire for that to be cleansed. Lord, we come to you with the faith that we have been given by you. We recognize you are the giver of all gifts. We thank you for the breath in our lungs this morning. And we praise you, for you are great and you are worthy to be praised.
There's a calm that covers me.
It's the place of healing. It's the place where I find freedom. There's a place my eyes can't see, where my spirit longs to be. It's the place of healing. It's the place I'll live in freedom. I'm gonna lift my hands till I can reach heaven. I'm gonna shout your name till the walls come falling down. I've come to worship. I've come to worship.
Worship you, God.
There's a love that lives in me. For you, Lord, my Savior King, who breaks the sin that's binding and leads me to a place of freedom. I'm gonna lift my hands till I can reach heaven. I'm gonna shout your name till the walls come falling down. I've come to worship. I've come to worship. I'm gonna sing my song like I am unashamed. I'm gonna shout for joy at the mention of your name. I've come to worship. I've come to worship. There's no one that can bring me peace, that can wash me clean like you, Lord. There's nothing in this world that can free me. Oh, you saved my soul. I'm gonna lift my hands till I can reach heaven. I'm gonna shout your name till the walls come falling down. I've come to worship. I've come to worship. I'm gonna sing my song like I am unashamed. I'm gonna shout for joy at the mention of your name. I've come to worship. I've come to worship. I'm gonna lift my hands till I can reach heaven. I'm gonna shout your name till the walls come falling down. I've come to worship. I've come to worship. Sing again. I'm gonna sing. I'm gonna sing my song like I am unashamed.
I'm gonna shout for joy at the mention of your name.
Amen.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever say, worthy give every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Worthy of every song. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. You're worthy, Lord. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Like you, there is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me.
There is none beside you.
else do we have but you, O Lord? Whom else do we need? God, we thank you. You are a solid rock. God, we can stand upon your word, your truth, your promises. You're faithful. In you, we are unshaken. Father, we thank you, Lord, that you came to dwell among men. God, that your Holy Spirit lives within us as we place our faith in your Son, Jesus Christ, who displayed the greatest love for us to die on a cross that we might be reconciled with you, a holy, righteous God, and one day spend all of eternity with you. How blessed we are. The joy of our salvation, Lord, is our strength. We thank you, Father. May we find joy in you, our great and awesome God, this morning. Lord, we pray that you would just move mountains in our hearts, that you would open our eyes, that you would break strongholds, and Lord, reveal to us your will for us, for our lives. Thank you for your word. We bless your name. You are holy. You are mighty. And we love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, good morning.
Thank you for listening to Change the World with Pastor Vic Carroll from Calvary Summerville. It is our hope that this message will help you grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, with today's message, here's Pastor Vic.
Let's pray. Father, we do praise your name this morning, Lord, and we are thankful for your mercy, for your kindness towards us, Lord. We lift up our hearts in praise unto you, God, and we just magnify your holy name. We declare, Lord, that you, the creator of the universe, creator of heavens and the earth and all that is in them, Lord, the creator of mankind, and you have created us, Lord, for a purpose, and the purpose is that we might have fellowship with you, that you take joy in our fellowship, Lord. And we have been given that distinct honor through the blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, and his death upon the cross that has reconciled us unto you. And so again, Lord, we give you thanks. We give you thanks, Lord, for just the majesty of your word. You said you have exalted your word even above your name. So this morning, Lord, as we open up your word, I just pray for a mighty moving of the Holy Spirit. I pray, Lord, that you would meet us, each of us, right here, where we're at, Lord, and that we would feel your presence and we would feel and absorb your truth. May we go forth in spirit, Lord. May we hear from you this morning from on high. We offer this time to you. We ask for your blessing upon it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Let's all turn in our Bibles to the Gospel of Luke, and we are in chapter 11 as we continue our journey through God's Word. Luke chapter 11. Last time you'll remember how Jesus was confronted by a man who was an expert on the law of Moses, and he asked Jesus, "What shall I do to inherit eternal life?" Implying that eternal life is something that could be merited or earned. And Jesus simply replied, if you are endeavoring to earn salvation, to earn righteousness, apart from having me impute my righteousness unto you, then you already know what to do, being a lawyer. You got to keep the law. You got to keep it perfectly. Be perfect. Never sin. Never miss the mark. In other words, the guy thought he was a really good law keeper, but Jesus says, being good ain't good enough. To qualify for heaven, God's requirement for heaven is perfection, which no human being can do. Thankfully, the God of the universe came and did it for us. He came and personally fulfilled his own requirement of perfection so that man could be saved, not by an impossible works, but simply through faith. Then Luke closed out the chapter 10, by introducing us to two sisters, Martha and Mary. And through them, Jesus communicated how vital it is in the Christian walk that we have this perfect balance between you and I serving ministering to others, but also spending an adequate amount of time at Jesus' feet being ministered to ourselves. Christians who struggle with their faith, Christians who struggle with burnout in serving or frustration, Christians who struggle with bitterness or struggle with, you know, the ups and downs of life, it's always because they aren't spending enough time each day at Jesus' feet. And we begin here in verse 1 of chapter 11. It says, "Now it came to pass, as he, Jesus, was praying in a certain place, when he stopped praying, that one of his disciples said to him, 'Lord, teach us to pray, as John also taught his disciples.'" A couple years ago, someone came up to me and said, "You know, I think your opinion on Catholicism might be offensive to Catholics." And I said, "Well, my opinion on Catholicism or anything else makes no difference or should make no difference to Catholics or anybody else. What matters is what God says. And what matters is what is in his word." And then they said, "Well, I've got a friend coming. I invited a friend to church and she's Catholic. And so would you please just don't pick on the Catholics this week?" I said, "I promise you this. I promise you that I will read scripture just as it's written. And I will explain it just as it's written. And I promise you that I will do it with the greatest amount of love that I can possibly speak." And you know, that's the only thing we can do. Anytime where we have differing opinions or whatever, theologically or doctrinally, the only thing we can do is to take that opinion and put it in a side-by-side comparison of God's word. And Jesus is going to speak some interesting things today that I want us to take note. And as he is... His disciples are watching him pray, as they had seen him pray many, many times. And they recognize, when he prays, they recognize the power. They see an intimacy with the Father that is facilitated through prayer. They see a spiritual strengthening that takes place through prayer. And they recognize it. They recognize that it's something that they want. It's something that they need. And so they let Jesus finish his prayer, and then they ask him, "Will you teach us to pray?" Because if Jesus, the perfect Son of God, had to rely so heavily on prayer while he was on this earth, as he did, how much more so will they or anyone else have to rely on prayer, anyone who desires to live a spiritually fruitful life? Warren Wiersbe says, "Effective prayer is the provision for every need and the solution for every problem." So, "Lord, teach us to pray." And so he said to them, "When you pray, say." And he's about to speak what you and I know as the Lord's Prayer, or the Our Father. And what I first want to point out before we get to it, I think it's important to note what Jesus does not say regarding how we should pray. It's just as important as what he does say. He doesn't say, you know, "Lord, teach us how to pray." He doesn't say, "All right, you want to know how to pray? Then you're going to need to memorize the words that I'm about to speak to you. You're going to need to write them down and recite them all throughout the day. And you're especially going to need to be able to recite this prayer when you go into confession and you know, ever how many Our Fathers the priest tells you to recite in order to facilitate forgiveness." He doesn't say that, because that would make forgiveness a works-based proposition. And it would make your relationship with God, at best, a robotic relationship. And the exact opposite of the personal relationship that Jesus has facilitated between God and man upon the cross. So of course he doesn't say that. Understand, as Jesus is teaching them to pray, he's not so much focused on the words as he is the heart behind the words. Jesus is not teaching them a prayer. He's teaching them how to pray with the proper attitude and mindset. As Jesus says in Matthew's gospel, pray in this manner, or pray with this mindset, or this heart. This is how I want you to pray. Prayer is not an incantation of empty words. Now, I can pray the Lord's Prayer word for word, and I have many times growing up in an athlete in team sports. Jesus is not saying it's wrong to recite this most famous prayer in the world, but simply that it's meaningless in terms of talking to God if it's not done with an engaged and sensitive heart. I was flipping through the channels the other day, and on the cable there's a whole network, a whole channel that is dedicated to just Catholic TV, Catholic teachings. And I stopped on it, and there was this, it was a nun, she looked like she probably was 100 years old, and she was reciting the Our Father and the Hail Mary back and forth, alternating between the two. She would recite part of it, the congregation would recite the rest of it, and they just kept alternating between the two. And over and over and over, the same thing with a very, very monotone kind of voice. And I'm sitting there, I'm thinking, what is the purpose? What is the point? About that time, my son came around the corner. He's like, what are you watching? I said, this Catholic TV. And he sat there and looked at it for a while as they, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, you know. And then they go on to the Hail Mary, back and forth and back and forth. And he said, I feel like somebody's about to come out of that TV and kill me. Like just the oppression. Like, and it was true. It's very, very, very sad. Prayer has nothing to do with incantation and being able to memorize and speak and recite. It's all about the heart when we pray. As Jesus says, pray with this kind of heart. And he begins here, Our Father in heaven. Recognize first off who it is your prayers are to be addressed to. And I don't want to get too dogmatic about this. I hear people praying to Jesus, or I don't think there's anything wrong necessarily with that. I think God knows your heart and God sees your heart. But we do see here the example here that Jesus gives us. And I think it's important to recognize that God has orchestrated, he has orchestrated it so that all three parts of the Godhead are at work and play a specific role in our prayers. And we don't want to directly or indirectly eliminate any part of the Godhead when we pray. Yes, Jesus is God, in essence, and the Holy Spirit is God. But Jesus says here, we pray directly to the Father in the name of the Son, meaning it's Jesus' authority and his imputed righteousness that has given us access to the Father. And as we do that, as we are praying to the Father in the name of the Son, our words are being directed by the Holy Spirit. We see that in other places in Scripture. So we see Father, Son, Spirit at work in our prayers. It's a beautiful thing. So we pray, as Jesus says, directly to a very personal Father. And it's good that we're not, praying to just some energy source or whatever in the universe. When you pray, you're like, dear cosmic force, I've got a couple things I want. If you're born again, if you're born of the Spirit, you got to be born into God's family to be able to pray this way. But if you are, if you're born again, we pray to our Father. And to the Jews, for Jesus to say this, even to the disciples, this was unheard of. In no way would you ever address this holy, righteous creator of the universe in such a personal way. But Jesus says now, come and has ushered in this close personal family relationship between God and those who are his children. He is your father, and so we can now address him as father. He's personal. He's dad. We just don't ever get so personal, that you ignore the reverence that is due him, as Jesus is going to talk about here. Don't ever get so personal, you know, where you don't ever want to begin your prayer with yo pops, you know. He's your Abba, he's your dad, but he is still God. He is hallowed. Jesus says to the Father, hallowed be your name, or holy is your name. So pray to the Father with the proper respect of who he is, and then what is to be a vital part of your mindset as you pray is your prayers are to be filtered through the paradigm of your kingdom come, God, your will be done, God, on earth as it is in heaven. That's an extremely important thing to remember in your prayers. And what is a reality related to prayer that the prosperity teachers like to ignore is that as I pray, before I ask anything, I'm letting God know that the foundation of my prayer, everything that I pray, everything that I ask, is going to be sifted through the paradigm of God's will. God's will supersedes any and all petitions that I am going to lay before him. I have prayed too many things in my life that things didn't turn out the way that I had prayed for. When you get down the road and you look back and you say, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you are sovereign and that your will is above what I ask. Because you know the future. I don't. You know what I need even before I ask for it. And so I have to pray every prayer through the paradigm of God's will. That is the foundation. His will takes precedence over me getting the job that I'm praying for. His will takes precedence over me getting the promotion. It takes precedence over me buying the house or being healed of whatever. Whatever it is that I'm going to ask of God in my prayers is secondary to God's will. That's the mindset that Jesus says we are to have before we even begin to bring our petitions before God. Verse 3, give us day by day our daily bread. Speaking of physical bread, whatever your physical needs are, you bring those needs to the Lord. And notice, you're not concerning yourself with tomorrow's bread. Jesus didn't say, pray for a storehouse full of bread. We pray for our needs, not our greeds. And he says, verse 4, and forgive us our sins. Daily we need to be asking God, search my heart, forgive me, and cleanse me of all unrighteousness. And then, for we also forgive everyone who is indebted to us. Don't expect God to do for you what you're not willing to do for others in return. Being forgiven by God requires you to have a forgiving heart towards others. Forgiveness in a human heart is one of the hardest things that God asks of us when we become a Christian. But God asks it of us because it is what single-handedly emulates and represents the heart of Christ in the world. A forgiving heart, even toward your enemies. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. Temptation literally means a test. Not that God would ever tempt you or that God would ever test you. James 1:13 says, let no one say when he is tempted, I am tempted by God. For God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he himself tempt anyone. So though God does not tempt us, what Jesus is talking about here is how God will sometimes allow us to pass through periods of testing. And me being aware of my own weaknesses and my own vulnerabilities, I ought to pray, Jesus says, with fervency that God would keep me away from situations where I might be vulnerable. So do not lead me into temptation is saying, God, protect me from myself. And if I'm praying that prayer, if I'm praying that as part of my prayer, lead us not into temptation, if I'm praying that with a sincere heart, it'll show in two different aspects of my life. Number one, I'm never going to boast in my own strength. I'm never going to get too cocky. Like, oh yeah, I got that sin defeated a long time ago. Yeah, you know, good Christian that I am. I don't even worry about that one anymore. I'm going to always be very aware of where my power comes from. My power and my victory over sin. I know where my help comes from. And then number two, I'm never going to put myself in harm's way. Listen, if I'm praying, lead us not into temptation, then I'm going to be very proactive in making sure that I don't put myself in a situation where I might be tempted beyond what I can stand. Spurgeon says, a man who prays, lead us not into temptation, and then walks himself right into temptation, is a liar before God. And so that's the Lord's Prayer. And as you can see, you might, if you have a Catholic background, you're like, well, wait a minute, that's a little different than the way I remember it. And it is a little different wording here in Luke than what we have taught for us, you know, this basic prayer that Jesus taught in the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew's Gospel. There's some differentiating words here and some words left out. And the fact that the wording is somewhat different is further evidence, I believe, that Jesus didn't want this prayer to be used in any sort of ritualistic way, as we see with the Catholic Church. Jesus warned, in fact, in Matthew's Gospel, if you look over in chapter 6, don't turn there, but look later. But he warned of what he called vain repetitions when you pray. That is, praying empty words, moving our lips, but not moving our hearts. Memorizing and vocalizing words as part of a religious ritual, thinking that it is bringing God some sort of gratification. Jesus warned against that, as if praying five Our Fathers is going to grant me favor or satisfy me some sort of penance or give me, you know, forgiveness over something that I've done. It's ridiculous. It's tragic. It's leading so many people astray. And honestly, it is an absolute affront to God, because what you are communicating to God by saying that I can do anything or I need to do something to add to the salvation process, I need to add to your grace by saying these prayers and reciting these sort of things, what it's saying to God is that the cross is not enough. The blood of Christ was insufficient. You're saying, okay, God, you did your part in saving me on the cross. I appreciate that. Now it's up to me to get my part done. Well, that throws being saved by grace through faith right out the window. That's why Catholics won't call themselves born again. Because it's no longer grace. It's no longer a free gift the minute that I have to work for it. If I've worked for something, I've earned it. It's not free anymore. But God said, salvation is free. Grace, charis, gift, free gift. But that's what the Catholics teach, that the work of Jesus on the cross was good, but not good enough. There's still work to be done for each of us individually if we're going to get into heaven. And not just Catholics, every other religion in the world teaches a merit-based salvation, where they either dismiss the cross and the message of Jesus altogether, or at the very least, they minimize the effectiveness of the cross, and thus salvation becomes, at least to some degree, a matter of works. When Paul wrote to the church in Corinth, again, I said, it's not about my opinion. Let's look at what the Word says about this. When Paul wrote to the church in Corinth regarding the gospel and the salvation message that he himself had delivered to the Corinthians. 1 Corinthians 2, verses 1 and 2, Paul said, "And I, brethren, when I came to you, did not come with excellence of speech or wisdom, declaring to you the testimony of God, for I determined not to know anything among you except Jesus Christ and Him crucified." That's the crux of the salvation message, Jesus and Him crucified, and nothing else. No matter what man tries to add to it for his own personal benefit, the gospel equation has always been, and it will always be, salvation equals faith plus nothing. And then a warning for anyone who would try to add works or try to add anything to the salvation process. Paul said to the Corinthians, it's Jesus and Him crucified. And then to the Galatians, Galatians 1:8. He said, "But even if we, the apostles, the ones who brought the gospel into the world, if we, the apostles, or even an angel from heaven, preach any other gospel to you other than what we have preached to you, if anyone comes with a different or altered message other than Christ and Him crucified, anyone who seeks to add or take away from Christ and Him crucified in that message," Paul said, "let him be accursed or damned." The disciples asked Jesus to teach them how to pray. And what did we learn? Seven things I want to point out. Number one, we learned that our prayers are not to be religious or ritualistic, but they are to be personal and intimate words spoken to God from the depths of our hearts as a child would speak to his father. Number two, we learned that we are to bring all of our cares and our petitions before the Lord. Nothing is too big or too small. And then number three, when we do that, whatever we bring to the Lord in prayer is to be done with an attitude and mindset that God's will supersedes anything that I might ask of Him. Number four, we learned that when we come to God and our prayers are prayed through the paradigm of God's will being supreme, then we know that God is faithful 100% of the time to answer those prayers. Number five, we learn that as we are praying to this personal God and the one who has established this beautiful father-son or father-daughter relationship, though we have been given this beautiful intimacy with God, we must never become flippant or fail to give Him the reverence that He deserves in our prayers. Number six, we learned that there are three things that we need to be praying for daily. Forgiveness of sins, daily. You might say, "Well, Pastor, come on, you sin every day." We all sin every day. Sin is just missing the mark. It's just being less than perfect. Anybody in here willing to say that they were absolutely perfect yesterday? Jesus said daily we should be asking God to forgive us our sins, as well the ability to forgive others. And then daily we need to be asking God to protect us from temptation. Number seven, we learned that through Christ, sinful man can now have fellowship and pray to a holy God. And not just to pray, but to pray with boldness, confidence, and persistence. As Jesus is going to further communicate in this parable here that He's going to give us beginning in verse 5. "And He said to them, 'Which of you shall have a friend and go to him at midnight and say to him, Friend, lend me three loaves. For a friend of mine has come to me on his journey and I have nothing to set before him,'" which would have been a catastrophe. In that day, in that culture, because it was a culture that was very driven by hospitality. "So I've got an unexpected guest, and I don't have enough bread. I don't have enough food to entertain and to be hospitable." And Jesus says, "And he, the friend, will answer from within and say, 'Do not trouble me. The door is now shut, and my children are with me in bed. In that culture, your house consisted of one big room, and everyone, you know, the whole family would sleep in the same open area. And so the guy says, you know, he's got a knock at the door, and from the inside, the guy's like, listen, I know you need bread, but listen, it's past bedtime. All the kids are asleep. Doors are locked, you know, everyone's asleep. So he says here, I cannot rise and give it to you. In other words, he has the means to supply your needs, but he refuses to do it. And then Jesus says, I say to you, though he will not rise and give to him because he is a friend, yet because of his persistence, he will rise and give him as many as he needs. Persistence, boldness. It took boldness for this man to go to his neighbor and ask for something that he was in need of, especially in the middle of the night. It takes boldness on our parts to go and to ask God for anything that we might need. Yet because of Jesus, the writer of Hebrews 4:16, says, let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace that we might obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. It takes a certain amount of boldness and confidence in our right or our liberty, our ability to pray and to ask God to meet our needs. But it's a right that Jesus has ushered in for us. And then sometimes, as it were in the parable that Jesus just illustrated, to go along with persistence in our prayers and boldness, God is looking for passion. He's looking for passionate persistence in our prayers. There's a purpose in persistent prayer. I want you to know. Not that God is reluctant in answering our prayers and needs to be persuaded, and if we just keep praying over and over, you know, and twisting his arm, eventually God's going to relent and say, okay, would you leave me alone already? Here, take the job. No, our persistence doesn't change God's mind. But what it does do is it changes our own hearts. And it helps to align our own hearts with God's will for that situation. Now, in this parable, understand that Jesus is not saying that God is like this grouchy old neighbor, who doesn't want to be bothered. You know, in fact, he's communicating just the opposite. The point is, if a grouchy old neighbor finally gets up and meets the needs of a friend who is bold and persistent, how much more will a loving heavenly Father meet the needs of his own dear children? That's the point. And so verse 9, Jesus says, I say to you who pray boldly and persistently, ask and it will be given to you, seek and you will find, knock and it will be opened to you. So first he taught us how to pray with the right heart and attitude. Now he encourages us to be bold and persistent in our prayers. Ask, seek, and knock. For everyone who asks receives, and he who seeks finds, and to him who knocks it will be opened. And if Jesus hadn't already established the attitude and the mindset by which you and I, his disciples, are to pray, then this would sound an awful lot like God's giving me a blank check here. Like he just made me the master and then him the servant. God, my servant. That now, whatever I asked of God, God has obligated himself to answer me in a way that is favorable to me. And there are many wolves in sheep's clothing out there who will try to get you to believe as much the prosperity, name it and claim it teachers, or the health and wealth doctrine as some call it. The problem is they forget that by the time Jesus makes this statement, ask whatever and it'll be given, seek and you'll find, knock and it'll be opened. By the time Jesus has made that statement, he's already laid out the foundation and has given us the paradigm through which all of his disciples are to pray. Remember, he said, when you pray, pray this way, with this mindset, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So what molds those two ideas together perfectly, me getting whatever I ask for without God losing his sovereignty, What molds those two ideas together is that for everyone who asks according to God's will, they will receive according to God's will. He who seeks finds, and to him who knocks, it will be opened according to God's will. Now, having said that, I don't want you to flip it, you know, the other way, and like a lot of people, well, then why bother praying then? If it's God's will that's going to be done, I don't want you to think that that diminishes the power in prayer. There's power in prayer. Why? Why is there prayer power in prayer? Because God designed it that way. And that's the way God wants it. God certainly is sovereign, and he doesn't need our prayers to help him accomplish anything. But for whatever reason, beyond my understanding, God in his sovereignty has chosen to partner with us in prayer in order to get things done. So again, Jesus stresses the importance of prayer. We need to be praying with intensity and passion and persistence. In fact, in the original language where it says ask and seek and knock, in the language it's the idea that you keep asking, that you seek and keep seeking, that you knock and you don't stop knocking until God answers. And then what I might add to intense, passionate, persistent prayer, another important characteristic when you're praying is patience. Because as you know, God doesn't always answer right away. Sometimes, you know, he takes a little time on this thing, and we get impatient. I get impatient. Be like, God, I've been praying and praying and praying and praying. It's been like 17 minutes. Still nothing. So it's important to be patient and to know that whenever God does answer, it's going to be much better for you when you add his perfect timing to his perfect will. But Jesus further makes his point in verse 11. If a son asks for bread from any father among you, will he give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, will he give him a serpent instead of a fish? Or if he asks for an egg, will he offer him a scorpion? My son, he comes, he asks for an egg, and every time he does, I give him a scorpion. He falls for it every time. Who's going to do that? Rhetorical question, obviously. Do we not, as parents, provide the needs of our children according to what we know is best for them? Children don't know what's best for them. And sometimes they ask for things that are not in their best interest. And a good parent acts in accordance with what is best for the child. Point being, if you then, verse 12, being evil, you and I as parents in comparison to God, if you know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? And so the picture here is just the goodness of God and the faithfulness of God, the love of God, in that he loves blessing his children. He loves blessing our socks off. And is there a greater blessing or a greater gift to a human being than the gift of the Holy Spirit, truthfully? So God knows how to give good things to those who ask. And the point that Jesus is making is that we need to ask and keep on asking. We need to seek. We need to keep on seeking. We need to keep on knocking. The psalmist says, taste and see that the Lord is good. In other words, test him, try him. God says, try me. Take him up on his offer to bless you. But you got to ask. You got to have a healthy prayer life. Don't ever let a reason your prayer doesn't get answers because you're not praying it and not praying it enough. You got to ask. Have a healthy prayer life. That's what Jesus is teaching here. Luke continues, and he was casting out a demon. Jesus was casting out a demon, and it was mute. And so it was, when the demon had gone out, that the mute spoke, the man spoke, and the multitudes marveled. But some of them said, he cast out demons by Beelzebub, the ruler of the demons, which is another name for Satan among the Jews. So the enemies of Jesus, they come along, they see him casting out another demon here, and it was an obvious supernatural thing that happened. They can't deny his power. They can't deny the authority that he has, even over the demonic realm. So they affirm his power, but they say, you know, well, he has satanic influence. So his power is coming from hell. That's where it's coming from. And others testing him sought from him a sign from heaven, but he, knowing their thoughts, said to them, every kingdom divided against itself is brought to desolation, and a house divided against a house falls. If Satan also is divided against himself, how will his kingdom stand? Because you say, I cast out demons by Beelzebub. So Jesus is saying, "What you guys are illogical. Think about what you're saying, what you're ascribing to the situation. The devil is fighting. He's fighting to win. And he may be dumb, but he ain't stupid. He's not stupid enough to wage war against himself and against his own kingdom. The devil casting out his own demons, his own soldiers, makes no sense. And then Jesus asked the Jews, and if I cast out demons by Beelzebub, by whom do your sons cast them out? This is not the first time that they're witnessing an exorcism. It happened way before Jesus came on the scene in person. There were Jewish exorcists. And Jesus points out the hypocrisy here. He says, when your exorcists cast out demons, you're not ascribing that they are doing so under the influence of Satan. He says, therefore, they will be your judges. But if I cast out demons with the finger of God, that is effortlessly, with ease, if I do that, there's only one explanation. Surely, the kingdom of God has come upon you. And therein lies the problem regarding the hearts of the religious Jews. Therein lies the problem of many unbelievers today. To admit the miracles and the supernatural things that Jesus did upon this earth is to admit that he is sent from a higher power, that he is sent from heaven. They would have no choice to admit, but to admit that Jesus was sent by God. So that's why they try to come up with something that's even illogical. Well, he's sent from Satan. I'm sent from Satan to destroy Satan? How much sense does that make? I can only be sent by God. For a person who sits down and just rationally looks at the evidence. And again, we're doing this on Wednesday nights. You just sit down and look at the evidence. It's absolutely overwhelming. Verse 21, when a strong man, he says, speaking of the devil here, when a strong man, fully armed, guards his own palace, his goods are in peace. His goods being those who have come under his control and influence. But when a stronger than he, that is Jesus, comes upon him and overcomes him, what does he do? He takes from him all his armor in which he trusted and divides his spoils. The only way that anyone can plunder a strong man's house is that you have to be stronger than the strong man. And so Jesus is saying here that the only logical explanation for him having the ability to exorcise demons is not because Satan is fighting against himself, bringing down his own kingdom, but it's because Satan is fighting against one who is much more powerful than he is. He's overmatched. As strong as he is, and Satan is strong, he's powerful, but he's powerless when he stands toe-to-toe with our Lord Jesus Christ. And Jesus, in this illustration, has just walked into Satan's kingdom. In fact, he's just walked into Satan's house. And he has defanged him, so to speak, and he's stolen from him one who was previously Satan's property, this demon-possessed man. And there's Only one logical explanation for that, that Jesus is much stronger than Satan. So verse 23, he says something very telling that I think people ought to stand up and take notice. He said, Jesus says, he who is not with me is against me, and he who does not gather with me scatters. In other words, when it comes to Jesus and being saved by grace through faith in Jesus Christ, the salvation message that he has brought into human history, Jesus wants you to know that there is no such thing as neutrality. There's no gray area in this regard. People will say, you know, I'm not really for this whole Christianity thing, but I'm not really against it either, you know, to each his own. And what Jesus is pointing out here is that your neutrality is a decision. Indecision related to Jesus is a decision of rebellion against him and his gospel. If you don't choose to be for him, he says, you're choosing to be against him. He says, when an unclean spirit goes out of a man, and here is this man standing there that Jesus has just delivered from a demonic possession, and Jesus is now going to use him as an example to teach a lesson. He says, when an unclean spirit goes out of a man, in other words, this man is now in this transition period where the demon has moved out, but the man has yet to ask Jesus to move in, which is going to be his only protection, by the way, from having this particular demon return, as we're going to see. And the exorcised demon, Jesus says, he goes through dry places seeking rest and finding none. He says, I will return to my house from which I came. And when he comes, he finds it swept and put in order. In other words, Jesus has come and delivered this man and set him free from the clutches of Satan. And now, having been delivered from the hand of Satan, the demonic influence has been moved out. But rather than giving his heart and his life to Jesus, rather than asking Jesus to come and take residence in his heart, he's going to try and remain neutral. That is to say, you know, I don't want anything to do with Satan in his kingdom anymore. That's all in my past. I don't want anything to do with that anymore. But I don't want anything to do with Jesus and his kingdom either. And then let's see what happens in this man's abode, in his heart. Then he, the demon, goes and takes with him seven other spirits more wicked than himself. And they enter and dwell there, and the last state of that man is worse than the first. So here's a man, he thought he's getting his life cleaned up. He decided he wants to be a good person. He wants to live by a certain moral standard. He's going to live a clean life. But again, he's going to do it on his own from a position of spiritual neutrality. He gets his life cleaned up to a certain degree, but again, he stops short of putting his faith in Jesus and letting Jesus come in and really clean up his life. And as a result, his heart is left vacant. And so when the demon, who couldn't find any other place to live, demons love to embody people. They don't want to be without a home. And so they're searching. They love to embody people. Demonic possession is real. Or Jesus wouldn't be talking about it here. This demon, when he returns, not only is he able to move right back in, but he moves in seven cohorts with him who are more wicked than he is. And the point that Jesus is making is that merely purging and cleaning house, trying to become a good person, is not enough. We must also invite the right tenant to come in and reside in our hearts. And the only thing that is guaranteed to protect, you know, a person from demon possession is to have your body, your house, occupied by Jesus. Otherwise, what you're doing is you're broadcasting all over hell. Even if you think you're neutral, you're broadcasting a vacant heart All over hell, you know, they see that flashing neon sign. Vacancy, vacancy, vacancy. And that advertising is even more ramped up and even more noticed all over hell as you steep deeper and deeper into sin. And that's the point that Jesus is making to Israel. Even if you have clean houses, which they didn't, it's the picture of being justified or cleaned up by the law, by being a good person. Even if the law cleaned your house, even if being a good person could make you clean, recognize that your house is still empty. Your heart is still empty. And here's the message, plain and simple. A clean house, religion, is not good enough. What matters is regeneration, the receiving of Christ into your heart, being born again, being born of the Spirit, inviting the right tenant once you have expelled the destructive one. And so even if you are able to exorcise that demon, you kick him out, unless you fill that vacancy with Jesus, with the Holy Spirit, that demon's just going to come back. And what's worse, he's going to come back with friends that are bigger and stronger and meaner than he is. And you're going to be much worse off than you ever were before when you had that one demon exorcised. In verse 27, it happened as he spoke these things that a certain woman from the crowd raised her voice and said to him, "Blessed is the womb that bore you and the breast which nursed you." And so notice, before Jesus ever even makes it to the cross, we see the propensity of man seeking the veneration and the exaltation of Jesus' mother, Mary. And Jesus, without speaking in a way that would be demeaning to his mother, he's going to set this woman straight regarding who it is that is truly blessed. And it's going to be recorded for us here. I think Jesus is going to record this so that down throughout history, no one would ever be tempted to revere Mary, the mother of Jesus, any more than you would revere any other person that's saved by grace through faith. And here's an opportunity. If Jesus were going to set up the church to where Mary was going to have this big responsibility and even go on to become a co-redemptrix, if she was going to be hailed and even be given some sort of attitude of divinity, Jesus certainly would have spoken it right here. But he said, listen, more than that, blessed are those who hear the word of God and keep it. You think my mother is blessed, Jesus says? Oh no. Who are more blessed are those who hear the word of God and keep it. Now, what does it mean? First of all, who is it that perfectly embodies and personifies the word of God? It's Jesus Christ. He is the Word. John 1:1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. John 1:14. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Point being, the person who hears Christ and receives Christ to the point of becoming obedient to Christ is more blessed than even the woman who bore him. And Mary, listen, she became part of that blessed hope. She is part of the family of God. We will see her in heaven. Not because she bore Jesus, not because she was the mother of our Lord and Savior, not because she delivered him. She's in heaven because he delivered her. She's in heaven because she put her faith and her trust in Jesus, not just as her son, but as her personal Lord and Savior, just like everyone else did. And I think it's important, you know, people can get the wrong idea, I think, of Catholicism just being another denomination of Christianity. And I'm not going to go too deep, we're out of time anyway, into some of the what differentiates Catholicism from what I believe the Bible teaches. And some things that are downright heresy and leading people into eternal damnation. Not this Wednesday, where we're going to do the case for a pre-trib rapture. The following Wednesday, we're going to get into the different, I'll just say cults, Mormonism, Jehovah's Witness, and all that. And not this Wednesday, but the following Wednesday, we're going to have Charlie Campbell do the teaching on Catholicism. And because I know a lot of you have come from that background, or you know people who are, in it now. And I think it's important for us to know and to be able to differentiate exactly what the Word says in that regard. Not my opinion, not Charlie's opinion, not Calvary Chapel's opinion, what the Word says, what Jesus says, what God says in His Word. And so we'll be able to take a look at that next week. Let's pray. Father, we are so honored that you've chosen us to gather here today. We're so honored, Lord, just of that you reveal the truth to those, Lord, who are open to receiving it. I pray that you would keep us above religiosity, that you would help us, Lord, not to become religious and ritualistic, legalistic, Lord, things which you hate. But that we would continue to be molded by the heart of Jesus, that we would continue to be molded and shaped by the truth of your word, that we would be directed, Lord, by your Holy Spirit, and that we would be able to be the hands and the feet and the heart of Jesus in this world, Lord, and that we would be beacons of truth. Search our hearts, Lord, and purge anything that we have been turned aside to, any sort of fables, any sort of things that contradict your word. Reveal it and speak your word to us, Lord. You told us that if we ask, if we seek, if we knock, you're faithful to answer those prayers. You've told us, Lord, that you love us enough to give us the greatest gift, which is the Holy Spirit. And so fill us with your Spirit today, Lord, and help us to discern truth, and help us to speak the truth in love to others who have been deceived, Lord, not just with our words, but with our lives. Help others to see how you, in a personal relationship with you, coming into a human life can change us from the inside out. And it's a powerful, powerful evidence, a powerful testimony. We can do it with your help. Without you, Lord, we can do nothing. And so, be our helper. Be our paraclete, Lord. Come alongside us. Come within us, around us, above us, that we might finish out this race strong, and that you might come soon and find each of us faithful. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. This Wednesday, again, our Charlie Campbell video series, we will be on the case for a pre-trib rapture. I think that's important to also understand why, as Calvary Chapel, why we have a pre-trib view and exactly, what the proof is from Scripture in that regard. That's this Wednesday at 7 p.m. Next Sunday, we'll finish up Luke chapter 11. Let's all stand. I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice to worship you. Oh, my soul, rejoice. Take joy, my King, in what you hear. May it be a sweet, sweet sound in your ear. One more thing. Next Sunday, immediately after second service, I want to meet right here in the sanctuary, like at 12:45, just for a few minutes, and have, if you can make it, just to have a corporate prayer for the election. That'll be 2 days later. So that'll be next Sunday. So why don't you go ahead and keep that in mind and put that in your calendar. God bless you. See you next week.
Thank you for listening to Change the World with Pastor Vic Carroll from Calvary Summerville. It is our hope that this message will help you grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ.